The opinions expressed by the host and guests on Where Did the Road Go are their own and do not represent those of WVBR or its management. Our aim is to explore the fringe, lost civilizations, alternative science, the paranormal, and much more. Join us on the web at wheredidtheroadgo.com, where you can send us questions for our live or future guests via email or the live chat room. And remember to subscribe to us on iTunes. And now welcome to this week's edition of Where Did the Road Go?
And I am your host, Soraya, as always. And this week we got something a little different, something I've wanted to do for a while. And we're going to be talking about the life and influence of H.P. Lovecraft. And with us, we have Mr. Daniel Harms, correct?
Yes.
And such an appropriate last name for studying Lovecraft.
It really is, yes.
So, obviously, Lovecraft's stuff was fiction, but his influence in our society and in our culture has been very widespread and goes into non-fictional realms, especially in some cases where they try to force it into non-fictional realms, which we will get to as we go. But let's tell us a little about yourself. You work at Cortland College.
Yeah, I work at Cortland College. Of course, I do not speak for Cortland College on TV.
Right.
My fields of study have been both Lovecraft and magic in Western culture. So that those are my fields of study. I got into Lovecraft about, I'd have to say over 20 years ago. And when Lovecraft was still not really that popular. He was gaining popularity, but he was still sort of an underground phenomenon. And it's really been amazing to see how understanding and appreciation of Lovecraft has really taken off. So it's almost verging on mainstream at this point.
Yeah, yeah. And it seems like there are people out there who know, for instance, the cartoonish Cthulhu, without realizing even where it comes from now.
Oh, yes, yes.
It's gotten to that point of being big.
Yeah, you get your plush Cthulhus, and you get your all sorts of varieties. You get your vampire Cthulhus and the Cthulhus and tuxedos, all this sort of thing, which really didn't exist even, 10 years ago, maybe 20.
Yeah, the whole thing is just kind of broken wide open. Now, Lovecraft was born when?
Lovecraft was born in 1890.
Okay, and died?
1937.
Yeah, so he didn't live very, very long.
No, he didn't. He had a relatively short life.
Yeah, and none of his work, if I'm not mistaken, was really appreciated at the time.
Well, there were people who appreciated it. It was largely published in the pulp magazines, which was generally with, a lot of the stuff he appeared with was lower quality fiction. Not all of it, but some of it was just, sort of by the numbers wrote material. Lovecraft had a vision that took him beyond that, though. He did have a few minor publications during his lifetime, but they were never really able to find a publisher for him that would, at the time, that would really, take off with it. Mainly just little fan publications and that sort of thing.
Yeah, he never wrote a full book. It was always short stories.
He did write some works that approached the length of a novel. There were places, Case of Charles Dexter Ward would be an example. At the Mountains of Madness would be another. But these were, I think At the Mountains of Madness may have been broken into two parts and published. But he never really got to the point where people wanted to publish his novels. They were either too different or he might have been approaching the wrong people at the time. It's not entirely clear.
Well, I think that the problem with it being different is you look at the culture back then, and it was so far ahead of its time as far as horror fiction went that I don't think anyone even understood it.
There were some people who grasped it, but for the most part, a lot of people were, when people read the pulp magazines, they were really looking for something that wasn't what Lovecraft was bringing. They wanted to have more of a, sort of a psychic detective story where, you've got, it's very simple. You've got, the love interest. You've got the detective who has a mastery of the occult, and they solve it, and it's resolved, and everything's fine. What Lovecraft portrayed was an entirely different sort of universe where you've got these vast eons of time where humanity is just kind of the blink of an eye. And before and after that, you've got these civilizations of all these alien creatures that basically came and had, you know, built vast cities and were scientifically advanced or magically advanced, and then they kind of fell away, or, you know, fell asleep, or just vanished, and then they left some sort of remnants behind, and then people come in and see those. And it's very difficult for people to, especially at that time, to wrap their head around. Now that we've, you know, explored the universe a bit more, and science fiction, and, you know, talk about UFOs and things like that have become part of our culture, it's easier for us to think about, you know, other civilizations in that way. But back at the time, it was a very different sort of way to look at the world.
Yeah, and you know, popular in fiction too were simple monsters, sort of simple monsters like the vampire or Dracula or Frankenstein or the werewolf, and not these kind of mind-bending, unnameable horrors.
Yeah, well, I think Lovecraft did treat with those horrors at some point, but The Shunned House, one of his stories, is a vampire story, but it is some sort of, it's actually kind of a werewolf story too, because there's some sort of tale about a werewolf in the family, and then this family comes over, and what it basically does is there's some sort of creature down beneath the ground that feeds on people's life energy and manifests itself in fungus, and is just, you know, when he finally digs it up, it's just, he can see only one part of it. So it's sort of a vampire story, but it's also a ghost story and a werewolf story and an alien monster story. It's just, it's a really bizarre sort of thing. And Lovecraft was renowned for taking, you know, elements of folklore and scientific lore and things like that, and just kind of mashing them together and coming up with something that was unique and completely different.
Now, his life, he had a very isolated existence, didn't he?
He had an isolated existence in terms of, I'd say, his, in terms of his, let's say, his contacts. He did not, you know, really get out and see a lot of people. Now, it's also important to remember that Lovecraft did live with people. He lived with his mother. He lived with his aunts for most of his life. I mean, so there was human contact there. He was also very familiar with people through his letters, but that was mainly a lot of his, where his intellectual outlet was, through his letters. I mean, Lovecraft wrote probably a dozen letters a day.
Wow.
And when people talk, this is important, because when people talk about, you know, you see a lot of speculation about what did Lovecraft read? What did Lovecraft know? You know, all this sort of thing. You just have to remember, Lovecraft wrote a dozen letters a day, and only a small fraction of these have been published, but at the same time, we now have a really good understanding of what Lovecraft was familiar with, and, you know, where he went and who he knew, and, you know, all, and what he was reading and all these things, because, I mean, he just sat there and documented his life. And at times we really wish that Lovecraft would have maybe knocked off the letters a little bit and written some more stories, but it does make it very easy to, you know, be able to, there's a lot of rumors and misconceptions about Lovecraft. It's easy to dismiss them just by going into the letters.
Right, right. And he's occasionally been accused of things like racism in some of his stories.
Oh, Lovecraft was a racist. I'm not even going to try to dress that up. There is some really horrible racist stuff written by Lovecraft out there. And you just, Lovecraft was, I'd say, a product of his upbringing. Now, at the time, when you look at what were the way people were viewing race at the time, he probably should have known better. I mean, this was when people were starting to look at race as more of a social construct than a biological reality. And he never quite caught that. But there were many people, especially of, you know, his particular outlook, which I would call New England sort of gentry, which would have probably have held those views. And he got better about them, but he never really got away from them.
It seems like in his later stories, he was kind of moving away from it a little bit.
Yeah, when you start looking at alien creatures and saying, well, okay, these are just people like us. There's sort of a movement there. There's sort of an acceptance that, okay, maybe things have changed, but he could, you know, it was a very difficult move for him, I think.
Yeah, but you can see that development in the stories over time, slowly, reluctantly.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's not blatant racism.
It's not blatant racism. Some of the stories are pretty bad, but those are usually the earlier ones that people don't read. I won't get too far into this topic because Lovecraft could have been probably around the 1910s and maybe a little bit into 1920s was just had some pretty horrible racist diatribes and things like that. But I think that it was more of a matter. Lovecraft really did change over the years. He started to, you know, open up and become a lot more tolerant of people, especially as he started encountering people in different settings. He actually lived in New York City for 2 years. And part of that, just inspired a lot of xenophobia on his part, but it was also, you know, he was starting to get, you know, interact with people. And usually the best remedy for things like racism and xenophobia is to start actually going out and talking to people.
Right,
and
right.
The more he did that, the better off he got.
Okay, all right. Now, what was his upbringing like?
Lovecraft had a very difficult upbringing. I mean, well, in some ways, he was very, you know, his family was very well off for at least much of his early life. But then he had a number of tragedies, one of which is that his father died when he was young. Actually, his father may have actually contracted syphilis and went mad, and he was in the hospital. And Lovecraft claimed he had never been to a hospital, so we don't know whether he actually went to see his father or not.
I see.
So that happened. He went to live with his maternal grandfather, who then lost a great deal of his money on investments and died. So he had this great big house where Lovecraft was very happy, and you know, big library, big collection of books, lot next door where he could play and make little miniature cities and things like that. And he actually, after his grandfather died, he had to give that up too. So there's always this great sense of what it gave him is a great sense of loss, a great sense that, you know, there was something in the past that was really, you know, there were some great things that went on in the past. There were great civilizations. There were great, you know, great accomplishments. That was such a good time back then. And, but I think he did also acknowledge that if you try to go back to the past, you know, you really find that, you know, it's not what you wanted it to be. I think there on some level he did recognize that. And that's important because that's where the horror comes in. It's a lot of Lovecraft's fiction can really be read as, I'm trying to get back to where I was. It's people trying to, you know, explore the past, whether that's through, you know, research or trying to, you know, mental techniques to throw their mind back to the past or dream about another world. And they just don't end very well in any case. So that's kind of the friction that Lovecraft brings. You know, like, the past is great, but you wouldn't want to go back to it.
And the title of this one's escaping me, but it was the one where he is looking for the lost city that he keeps dreaming about.
Polaris? Is that the one?
No. And he travels all through the dream world, and it brings one of his latest
Dream stories. Quest of Unknown Kedath.
That's it.
Yes.
And, you know, the end of it comes down to him appreciating where he is.
Yeah.
Which is one of the few stories that didn't seem to have a really horrible end to it.
Yeah, that one was actually... that one's interesting. It's more of kind of a fun fantasy romp.
Yeah.
And he does, in the end, he just kind of realizes that what he was looking for was what he already had back in the waking world, and he just needed to learn how to appreciate it. That's one of the few cases where you actually see that sort of reconciliation with, you know, you've still got a great world that you can live in. For the most part, it just doesn't go very well. People end up dead or insane.
Right.
It just doesn't, you know, that sort of encounter with the past always brings them into just a whole bunch of trouble.
And he's really, is he one of the first that's come up with that idea of like this, these monsters that are completely indescribable? Like this element that's so overwhelming that it draws madness in?
I don't think he was the first one to do it. I think he was the first one to basically base a career of writing about it.
Okay.
I think there may be hints of it in Maupassant and Bierce and people like that.
Mm-hmm.
But he was the first one to really foreground that and really, you know, and more write more than say just a story about it. He really, you know, he really went into it and made connections between his stories about these, you know, alien races and how they interacted and things like that.
Now, did he have an interest in lost civilizations?
He, to some extent, yes. I think he was interested more in their imaginative potential than anything else. I think Lovecraft did say at one point that he didn't really get anything past Rome. In terms of his actual, you know, what engaged his mind. So I think he was more interested, as I said, in the imaginative potential, you know, just understanding that there are these vast, you know, ancient civilizations out there. And he was aware of them. He did try to keep up with the literature about them in the newspapers and places like that. But he's more interested in kind of their what they signify.
Mm.
So he does write some things about Egypt and that thing. He did a piece with Houdini, in fact, called Under the Pyramids, which was later published as Imprisoned with the Pharaohs. Apparently, Houdini had a rather dull sort of trip to Egypt.
Mm.
And what he decided to do was, okay, you had a dull trip to Egypt, but then there was this whole scene where some people decided they were going to have a fist fight on top of the Great Pyramid. So he went out at moonlight to do it. And then they tied him up and they tossed him into the tunnels beneath the Great Sphinx. And he was wandering around in there and there were all sorts of mummies and things like that. So he could engage with it and he had some knowledge of it. But I think intellectually he was very much a creature of two periods. It was probably ancient Rome and the 18th century.
Mm.
So he loved 18th century authors and ways of writing and things like that. And he tried to sometimes ape them, and he was just really bad at it. one of the things that kept him, which makes him intriguing, is he takes that sort of love of history and brings into it sort of a 20th century sensibility. When you look at his work, it's very, in a sense, clinical. It's very much of a description of, you know, very factual description of things. There are some, you know, he encountered the horrors and then things just kind of go off the rails. But for the most part, it's very much, you know, it's very specific as to times and places and people and what happened. And, you know, just being able, bringing in scientific discoveries. And when he encounters the aliens and at the Mountains of Madness, it's very detailed about what these things look like. I mean, it just goes on for pages and pages. It's this big. This is what the, you know, these are what the wings look like, and this is how they fold into the body and all this sort of thing. So I think that's what really has brought Lovecraft to prominence, which is that, you know, the ability to bring together that sort of alien sensibility with a very sort of scientific mindset.
Mm, okay. Does he have any female characters in any of his stories?
He does. The one who's coming immediately to mind, unfortunately, is Azanith Waite from The Thing on the Doorstep.
Mm.
And Azanith Waite is actually debatable as to whether she's female. I'm going to give spoilers for this story. Sorry, folks. but it is basically her mind has been taken over by that of her father.
Ah, okay.
And now so she gets married to a young man, and then she's, because he wants to take over his mind. So there's this whole element by which, the female characters in his work are either kind of peripheral or they're just, you know, horrible people who are trying to take over men. And Lovecraft seems to have gotten along well with women. He doesn't really seem to have, I'd say, understood them all that well.
Okay.
Which is, as I said, he lived with women for his entire life, so it's a little odd. But most of his protagonists are male, and, you know, they have male friends, and that seems to be the dynamic.
It was early 1900s, too, which isn't that surprising.
Well, I think that some people have actually hypothesized that Lovecraft was gay just because of all, you know, he has so few female characters. But there's He was probably asexual, I think. He just was not interested in the topic that much. Hmm. But that was, in terms of the literature he was reading, it was pretty normal to, see that sort of male bond forming.
Yeah, there's no love stories in there at all.
Generally, there's a couple of love stories, but they're sort of off on the side. Yeah. They're not really central to the action. When they are central to the action, it's because Lovecraft is rewriting somebody else's story, usually. There are some of his revisions, which a lot of people don't read, but I enjoy the revisions. He's really put a lot of effort into some of these tales that he was rewriting for other people so they could get it published. But he... those do have sort of a love story, but you can tell he's not really interested in that. He wants to talk more about some sort of weird books or strange cult that's going on at the time,
or people coming back from the dead.
Yeah, all those sort of things. Love is just, I think he's actually, he writes in his letters, he's not really that much into love. It just seems to be some sort of biological necessity that he's just not too concerned with. I'm not getting it quite accurate on that, but he didn't really seem to be too much into it, even in his personal life. He was married.
Okay.
I think it was largely her idea. Hmm. They seem to have gotten along well enough intellectually, but as for, it didn't last long. In terms of them living together, I don't think he ever got divorced, because that was something a New England gentleman did not do.
Mm.
But after a while, they tried to move to New York City and make it all work out. But eventually she moved to Cleveland. He moved back to Providence, Rhode Island. And that was pretty much the end of it.
And no kids or anything like that?
He did have... His wife had a child from the previous marriage.
Okay, but he didn't have
He didn't have any kids. He seems to have been almost completely uninterested in sex. I think it was said that his wife said that kind of his way of expressing affection was to interlink pinky fingers and kind of go, like that. And, so you're not really expecting someone like that to, have a lot of kids.
Now, his writing style was very different.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't write story, and including leaving out, those type of love stories. Was it that people didn't understand the way he was writing at the time too?
Well, I think that was part of it. But as I said, they were probably expecting something else. They wanted to have something that was more conventional. I mean, we can say the love stories remain popular, from ancient times, even today. Right. I mean, it's just... And a lot of people will read that and say, this is the sort of thing they like. And Lovecraft was more writing about, I've got this scientist and, he's going out to, examine this problem. Or, I've got this folklorist and he wants to, research some cult up in the hills. And it's a little harder to relate to begin with.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
It's not most people's experience to have, this sort of this sort of thing going on in their lives. So that was I think it was very difficult for people to get into it. Fortunately, I think he had editors who sort of understood him. They would sometimes just, say, well, we can't publish this right now. And then he'd send the same story back a few months later and say, yeah, I made all those changes you wanted, which he hadn't in some cases. And then they go ahead and publish it. But there was at least some understanding on their part that, you have somebody, they had somebody there who was talented and could, basically bring them something that had some worth. Of course, one of the things about Lovecraft was that he was publishing Weird Tales, and I don't think he ever had a cover illustration for Weird Tales during his lifetime.
Hmm.
That went to the other writers who were writing, more sort of conventional fare.
Right.
So, after his death, people really started to say, "Oh, wait, that Lovecraft guy was really good." And it was interesting, because that's when things started to take off in terms of the fandom. People missed him. People started to reprint his stuff and reprint things that Weird Tales was reprinting things that they had turned down. And it really it really started to get the ball rolling on his fandom. It took a while, but that was kind of the impetus for things to change.
And that was, he died when?
1937.
So going into World War II and...
Mm-hmm.
So you had a big change in culture to begin with.
Oh, yes, yes.
And then the whole UFO era started in 47, 48, mm-hmm, so that mm-hmm. opened that up a little more, too.
Yeah. It's interesting because Lovecraft sort of presaged a lot of that in terms of thinking about, you know, what other civilizations are out there? You know, what do they intend for us? Lovecraft's kind of his hallmark is the belief that the universe is not inherently friendly, nor is it hostile. If you had alien species out there, what would they do? You know, what would they do if they encountered us? Well, in Lovecraft, at least one of his stories, what they do is they say, hey, you seem to be interesting. Let's go over here and dissect you.
Right.
And see what how exactly this works, this whatever you are works. So there was that notion that not a humanocentric notion that,
right,
that you
right.
know, we are important and the aliens will come and they will destroy us because they think we're so great, or we will conquer them because we think we're so great. They'll just be like, oh, well, that's interesting. What do we do with you? And I think that's what carried over and made him popular were some of the early people who were appropriating UFO sort of imagery and belief and incorporate and bringing it into their belief system. The White Brotherhood of Morris Doreal would be one of them. He's got a book called The Emerald Tablets of Thoth the Atlantean, which I think was published in the 40s or 50s. And it actually just starts taking stuff out of Lovecraft and putting it in there.
Really?
Yeah.
And is it meant to be fictional?
No, it's meant to be part of their belief system. And you just sit there and they're like, oh, wait, Yog-Sothoth? Why is Yog-Sothoth in here? but yeah, that's when I think it started to, people saw that there was a resonance there.
Mm-hmm.
And they started to bring it into their belief systems.
Okay. All right. And, you know, I should have mentioned this at the top of the show, but you've written quite a few books on Lovecraft and his work.
I've written two major books, I'd say. One of which is the Cthulhu Mythos Encyclopedia, which kind of goes into Cthulhu is Lovecraft's green squid-headed god, who... is probably his most famous creation, and so that book talks about, you know, how that mythology developed and how other people have appropriated it, because that's one of the things that have happened. A lot of people have started writing based their own material based on Lovecraft's work, and
right.
it's kind of spiraled outward from there. The other one is the Necronomicon Files, which is a book on Lovecraft's most famous creation, which is the Necronomicon of Abdul el-Hazred, a fictional book which contains all sorts of spells and incantations and lore about these, you know, horrible things that once lived on the earth, and how people started to appropriate that and write their own Necronomicons and start, you know, branching out from that until it became sort of this cultural phenomenon.
Okay, and what are the other books you have out?
Let's see, what other books do I have out?
Are they just shorter?
I've got some non-Lovecraft works out.
Okay. I thought you had a bunch of... I thought when I looked on Amazon, you had a bunch of them there.
I may have some others, but there may be short stories in various anthologies and some gaming products and things like that. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. And you were going to say you have some other books out as well?
Yeah. I'm actually writing in the field of ritual magic and folk magic and things like that. One of my recent books was The Long-Lost Friend, which is a Pennsylvania German manual of folk magic from 1820, which was a lot of fun to write and track down material on. So,
and it's just a collection of the different spells and things like
that. Yeah, it was actually put together by a guy who came over from Lorraine and in 1802 and basically was writing these books of magic so he could actually make a little bit of money on the side. Because he wasn't doing so great as a farmer.
Hmm.
But I think that's what it comes down to. But it's kind of... Then there's some interesting overlap between the two areas. Lovecraft was interested in magic and occultism, mainly as sort of window dressing for his stories. He liked to bring it in and just to just to dress things up a bit. And as he went on, I think he started using it less and less because he started to realize more of what he wanted was not so much, you know, sort of incantations from old books, but it was more being able to talk about, you know, the vast spaces of the cosmos and everything that, and what could be out there.
Okay. We have a question from a listener, and he wants to know if you know anything about the rumor that Lovecraft's father was a member of a secret society of some kind.
Well, this gets us into the topic of the various Necronomicons written by various people in imitation of Lovecraft. One of these was published in England. We call it the Hay Necronomicon. And with an introduction by Colin Wilson.
Mm.
And Colin Wilson invented this bit about Lovecraft's father being in a secret society. Now, what it actually derives from was the fact that I believe Lovecraft's maternal grandfather was a Freemason, actually started a Freemason lodge in the town of Coffin's Corners, which I think is now called Green. But the idea that he's trying to say is that, well, you know, Lovecraft's father was a Freemason, and he had access to this secret Masonic document.
Right.
And there is, I suppose, if Lovecraft's maternal grandfather was a Freemason, it might be plausible that his father could have been a Freemason. But what Wilson tries to say is that he was a member of an Egyptian Freemason lodge, and there's not much evidence for that.
Okay.
We don't really think Lovecraft's father was a member of a secret society. He was basically a traveling silverware salesman.
Ah, okay. How old was Lovecraft when his father died?
Oh, I have to look it up, but it's probably about 6 or 7.
Okay.
Yeah.
So probably didn't have a huge impact on his life at that point.
Yeah. It's questionable, as I said, because we don't know whether he visited his father in the hospital right. or anything like that.
But he probably wasn't passing down secret documents to him when he was 6 years old.
It's unlikely, yes.
All right, we got to take a quick break. We'll be right back with Daniel Harms.
The opinions expressed by the host and guests on Where Did the Road Go are their own and do not represent those of WVBR or its management. Join us on the web at wheredidtheroadgo.com, where you can send us questions for our live guests via email or the live chat room. You can also check out our upcoming schedule, blog, link section, book reviews, videos, and links to our Twitter, Facebook, iTunes, and much more. That's wheredidtheroadgo.com.
And tonight we are speaking with Mr. Daniel Harms, who is essentially a Lovecraft expert, I suppose.
I'm reluctant to say that, but...
You've written enough and studied enough about him, I think we can call you that.
Okay.
And if you have any questions for Daniel, you can come into the chat room at wheredidtheroadgo.com. That only applies if you're listening live Saturday night on WVBR or the internet. So... Let's get into the Necronomicon.
Okay.
Now, when did the Necronomicon first show up in his stories?
It first showed up in 1922 with the story The Hound, which is kind of a mashup of Poe and Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, you know, with The Hound of the Baskervilles and all that, Ambrose Bierce. Lovecraft just taking all that stuff and throwing it at the wall. You've got these two men who are... They're basically decadents, and they've got this whole room beneath their house decked out with all sorts of, you know, skulls and, you know, tomb relics and things like that. And so what they decide to do is they go out to a Dutch cemetery and dig up, you know, this wizard, and they say, well, he's got this amulet of a hound, like a hound with wings, and they say, okay, we're going to take that. And what happens is something comes after them, and it's not really clear from the story what that is, but it apparently is some sort of embodiment of the hound spirit. One of the things they do is they go and say, hey, we've got to figure out what this is. So we've got this book called The Necronomicon. Let's look and see what it is. Oh, yeah, that sounds really, really scary. It comes from someplace called the Plateau of Leng. And, it's has to do with some sort of corpse-eating cult. Well, it doesn't do it a whole lot of good about, you know, what do you do about when you, if you steal this? That was the first appearance. And as Lovecraft goes on, he starts using this more and more. It was one of his favorite things to use in stories. Other people also picked up and used it in their stories. It got to the point where people were sending letters to Weird Tales, and they're saying, okay, well, this is actually appearing in multiple people's stories, so does this book actually exist, and where can I find it? And then Lovecraft would write them a letter and say, yeah, this is a fictional work that I made up, and I'm really impressed that you think it's real, but, you know, it's don't worry about that, that it doesn't actually exist. And what would happen after Lovecraft's death is that, of course, Lovecraft was not available to write these letters anymore.
Right.
And a lot of people weren't aware of this background, so they started to say, okay, well, maybe there is a Necronomicon out there. And they would start putting, you know, ads in booksellers, journals saying, yeah, I want to buy a copy of the Necronomicon. And after, when you got up to about the 60s and the 70s, people actually started to be inspired to write them.
Mm.
And that's kind of where the Necronomicon craze started.
Now, what was the first one?
Let me think. It's hard to say which one the first one was right off the top of my head. You had a few little fan productions, people just writing small little excerpts, effectively. One of the first one that really appeared in book form was one by L. Sprague de Camp.
Hmm.
And that one was pretty much just an introduction with a bunch of fake Middle Eastern calligraphy. So it's like, oh, yeah. And he gives this introduction with this story about how some sort of antiquities directors in Iraq found this book. And they started, and the problem was they kept trying to translate it. But as they were doing it, they were reading it aloud. And then something would come down and then would eat them and then take them away. So eventually, the Iraqis at the time decided, well, you know what, we're going to give these to the Westerners so they can, you know, if they want to deal with this sort of thing, maybe that'll do them some damage right there. And that one was probably the first one that really caught people's attention. It came out from Owlswick Press.
Donovan in the chat room says the DeCamp one was from 1973. Does that sound right?
That sounds right, yeah. I know Donovan.
Ah, okay.
But yeah, the 1973 DeCamp edition was probably the first one that really caught people's attention.
And it was pushed as being a real book, like a nonfiction type of thing.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's hard to tell with these sometimes. I think it was probably marketed, the idea was to probably market to people in the know.
Mm.
And who would be aware that, you know, it was a limited edition. They probably wanted to just say, well, you know, you guys know what's going on with this. They didn't even call it the Necronomicon. They called it the Al-Azif, which is Lovecraft's Arabic title for it. So it's more of a, yeah, you guys know what's going on sort of right, dynamic right there. But the people who wrote Necronomicons later were not quite as cagey about it. They actually came out and
tried to claim it was real.
This is the Necronomicon.
Now, obviously, the most famous one is the Simon Necronomicon.
Mm-hmm.
And you address this in your book.
Yeah.
Now, how much of that book takes on that Necronomicon?
Of the Necronomicon files?
Yeah.
We spend a great deal of time on that one.
Okay.
Because that's usually the one that people ask about and that people are the most confused about.
Okay. You want to tell us a little about that and who Simon is?
Yeah. Simon is most likely a guy named Peter Lavenda. Some of your listeners might be familiar with him. He's the author of Unholy Alliance, which is a book on Nazi occultism, and a good number of other books. We know this because there's actually a document at the U.S. Copyright Office that says that with regard to one of Simon's books, that it's actually written by Peter Lavenda under a pseudonym. So the evidence is pretty strong there. And it's hard to tell what exactly happened, because Simon really has made a career out of trying to defend the fact that this Necronomicon is real. It's an actual ancient Greek manuscript, and, you know, this really happened. But what seems to have happened, at least from my perspective, is that Peter Lavenda had this idea that he was going to write a book that would bring together paganism and ceremonial magic. And one of the great let's call it, contradictions within 20th century occult practice has been that people who do not consider themselves Judeo-Christian want to have some magic. But the problem is all the written texts of magic are Judeo-Christian. So this, how, and they have to figure out, okay, so do we just change, can you change around some of the words? You know, can we use some parts and leave out some others? And so what he was trying to do is to bridge that, to take, you know, magic and give it sort of more of a pagan center to it. And to do that, he went back to Sumerian civilization, right, and Babylonian civilization. So he decided he was going to write a book about that. Now, one of the people with whom he was talking was Herman Slater, who was the owner of the Warlock Shop, later became the Magical Child Shop in New York City. And it may have been his idea, I'm not going to say it was, because as I said, it's a little unclear, to bring Lovecraft into it, because Lovecraft was becoming more prominent. There was actually a copy or copies of the DeCamp book for sale in the Warlock Shop at the time, and they originally marketed this book that was coming out as a translation of that book I was talking about before with all the fake calligraphy in it.
Right, right.
And of course now Simon has apparently developed some sort of amnesia about that book being there. It's like, oh, he wrote a book called Dead Names. Doesn't mention that book at all. It's just like, you know, if I were writing some, you know, if I found some ancient manuscript that said it was the Necronomicon and there was another copy of the Necronomicon for sale in the same shop where I was talking with people about it, I think that would be the sort of thing I'd want to bring up. It would be right, very memorable, right. But he doesn't even talk about that. So basically they decide, okay, well, this will probably sell more. This is at least, that once again, this is my speculation. This will sell more if we use the Necronomicon name on it.
Mm-hmm.
And so they put in some, it's kind of very superficial what they've done with regard to Lovecraft. They throw in a few Lovecraftian names. It's not quite, they're not quite what Lovecraft used, but they're close.
Right.
And they basically marketed it as the Necronomicon.
And I had picked up a copy. The first sign that anyone should have that this is not a genuine book of magic is the fact that it's mass produced. Mm-hmm. And you can find it in just about any bookstore. You know, and so I picked it up and I bought it because I wanted to read through it. And I read through it and I went, okay, so this is Sumerian, this is Lovecraft, this is Sumerian, this is Lovecraft. And he just kind of just smashed them together and put it out there.
And there's some later sort of pagan and ceremonial stuff. So it's kind of, it's this whole amalgam of different traditions that he's kind of put together. A lot, I won't say that it's not entirely fake material, because some of it's rephrased actual Sumerian and Babylonian right. prayers and things like that. Yeah. I mean, he's got those in there. It's just that, you know, if you want real, you know, material of that sort, there are plenty of sources out there that, you know, do not mix it up with, you know, Lovecraft right. at all. So this book, I think, got more popular than they were anticipating at first, because they were just publishing it out of, you know, I think Simon had to set up his own DBA company just to, you know, put it out. And then Avon picked it up, and it's probably in about, I think it's the 70th printing now.
Wow.
Yeah, so this, it really went above and beyond anything that anybody expected. And of course, this means that to this day, people keep asking questions about, did Lovecraft read about Sumerian and Babylonian material? And the answer is, yeah, but as I said, most of his emotional, you know, engagement with the past stopped at ancient Rome. He knew that these civilizations were out there. He could talk a little bit about Nineveh and Ur and places like that, but right. he really didn't get into it that much, and he didn't talk about it that much in his fiction.
Now, did the Necronomicon become less in his fiction as it went on?
I would say it changed in its roles.
Okay.
It started out as kind of this compilation of lore where you can, you know, read to see what the horrible hound amulet's doing. It then became a book of spells. That's especially in the Dunwich Horror. That's mm-hmm. kind of about 1928 or thereabouts. I think Donovan will give me a date if that one's off. but... yeah, late 20s, it's really about magic. And then it starts changing again in the 30s when you get to some of the later stuff. It's more about the, you know, a tale of these ancient civilizations that were, you know, that came before, and it talks about, you know, what was going on in those civilizations. So it would change throughout Lovecraft in terms of what exactly this book was and how it was used.
Right. Okay. And other people have come up with Necronomicons.
Yes, they have.
Since him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One of the notable ones is the Hey Necronomicon, which we talked about before, which is more along the ceremonial lines.
Mm-hmm.
It never, I think, got as big as the Simon book, just because I think people were... It's more kind of a highbrow bit. It doesn't go too far from the ceremonial roots. Once again, trying to take, you know, something that's Judeo-Christian, then bring in Lovecraft.
Right,
it,
right.
It doesn't quite, I'd say, I hate to say this, but it doesn't quite do it as well as Simon did. the other one is the Tyson Necronomicon. That appeared from Llewellyn several years ago. And that one is particularly interesting. Here's what happened. Okay, we're getting the Necronomicon files, you know, ready to go to Weiser.
Okay, and you wrote that with who?
John Wisdom Gonce.
Okay.
I should have said he's the co-author. I don't know if I threw that in earlier, but I'm putting it
in
now.
I don't think so. That's why I wanted to ask.
Yeah, definitely. Sorry, John. So we've gone to one publisher before. We had it out. The publisher, you know, almost had to close up, and we got the manuscript back. We're like, okay, let's give it to someone else. Let's give it to Weiser. And then John thinks about this and says, you know, we should have an introduction. Let's see if Donald Tyson, the ceremonial magician, wants to write this.
Mm-hmm.
Wants to write an introduction for this book. We're like, sure, that sounds good. Well, you know, I didn't know Donald Tyson that well. But I said, okay, well, you know, let's ask him. And he said yes. Now, what happened was it actually inspired Donald Tyson to start going back and start writing his own Necronomicon. He's like, yeah, let's go back and look at Lovecraft. And what he want, his goal was to make a Lovecraft faithful Necronomicon.
Hmm.
And at one point, I was even going to write the introduction to that Necronomicon. But as time went on, and this was not Donald Tyson's decision, the book went from being a fiction work to a nonfiction work somehow. In terms of marketing. And at that point, I said, okay, you know what?
Right.
If it were a joke, yes, but this is getting a little serious. But so that's why there's now this other Necronomicon out there, which by writing a book to kind of debunk the Necronomicon myth, we actually inspired. This is not what we anticipated happening. But, you know, it's a fun book.
All right.
And it's also inspired to some novels. There's a tarot deck out there and other things like that.
Mm-hmm,
so,
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now, what about Kenneth Grant? Let's get into a little of his work with Lovecraft and such.
Well, Kenneth Grant was the head of one of the branches, and this is where you get into that murky sort of territory. We'll call it a branch of the Ordo Templi Orientis, or the OTO, as popularized by Aleister Crowley.
Mm-hmm.
And whether this is actually an authentic branch or not is a matter of debate and a wrangling in the courts and things like that. But one of the things he did was in 1955 to 1962, he supposedly had a lodge called the New Isis Lodge, which was basically based around doing all sorts of strange magical works involving... various mythologies and also including them the works of Lovecraft.
Mm-hmm.
And what Grant's hypothesis was that Lovecraft was sort of a he was a prophet, but he was a failed prophet. He was somebody who looked into the abyss, which the magician is supposed to cross in order to gain ultimate enlightenment, and just said, okay, well, that's enough. And so the horrors from his fiction are actually expressions of deeper realities, which he just couldn't handle.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, I would actually, to some extent, I agree, because I think that Lovecraft in another place and time would probably have been, you know, a figure who would either be, you know, very respected for having, you know, mystical power, or he probably would have just gotten in a lot of trouble, depending on the time. I mean, he yeah. talks about his dreams. I mean, he's got these amazing dreams where it's not just, you know, your usual, you know, you went to work without your pants sort of thing.
Right.
We're talking
right.
about, you know, detail, you know, visions of these grand cities and, you know, just entire tales just told sequentially. And just some really, really amazing stuff. So in a sense, Lovecraft could have been in a previous time been considered a shaman or a prophet or something like that. But really, when you're born in early 20th century Providence, late 19th century Providence, the best he could do was probably be a Baptist or a Universalist or, you know, or Unitarian or you know, an atheist, which is where he settled. So, right. But whether that, I think that Lovecraft really was able to tap into something that really resonates with us, and whether that was something that some people will say, well, that means he was getting into some sort of mystical knowledge. Or whether you can say that was just, you know, he kind of got what scares people and what people find compelling on it, you know, on an emotional level, is up to, you know, somebody who might think about spirituality or, you know, how those things work.
Right, right.
And that's a position Grant took, that it was a spiritual understanding of the ultimate nature of reality.
Yeah, I've read a number of Grant's books, and some of them seem very grounded and very well written, and others seem to just kind of go off the deep end a little bit.
Yeah, I think that Grant likes to, or at the time liked, I think he died in 2011, was to basically take Lovecraft and, you know, all sorts of different mythologies and some of Aleister Crowley's work and mm-hmm. just kind of mash it all together and say, here you go. Let me see if I can make your brain explode. And, you know, just try and really try to disorient people. I mean, you can just be reading Kenneth Grant and you'd be talking about, you know, Egyptian civilization. And it's like, oh, yeah, well, you know, Lovecraft says this, and this guy kind of works together. And you're sitting there looking at it like, not really. But, you know, he is, you know, that was what he was trying to accomplish, yeah, was to yeah. try to create this, you know, fictional, semi-fictional world, which could then he could use to, you know, disorient people's minds and then kind of put them back together the way he wanted to.
And create kind of a new system of magic as well.
Yeah, to create a new system of magic, a new way of looking at the world.
I forgot what I was just going to ask you. It had something to do with Grant. Oh, no, actually, there are also people who believe Crowley and Lovecraft had some connection, but there's really nothing there, is there?
There's really nothing there. That was actually an early internet hoax, talking about how Crowley and Sonia Green, who was Lovecraft's wife later on, were lovers at one point, and there's absolutely no evidence of that. There is evidence Lovecraft knew about Crowley, but more in the sense of, I read some newspaper articles and actually thumbed through Diary of a Drug Fiend at one point. And that's pretty much what it was. Now, Crowley might have known about Lovecraft, but he doesn't really seem to have talked about him at all.
Yeah, I don't remember there ever being a reference.
Yeah, there's something. There was some sort of story I heard about Grady McMurdy, who was actually an officer during World War II, naming some Jeeps after Cthulhu Mythos monsters. I don't even know where that came from. So, and Grady would then meet with Crowley late and his wife, and they'd play chess, and eventually he became a prominent person in the OTO. But so it's possible Crowley heard about him, but there's not really a lot of evidence that he did or that he thought much of him if he did.
Right, right. And there's a lot of connections that Simon tries to make there.
Yeah, yeah.
And actually, give people your blog.
Yeah, my blog is danharms, one word, at wordpress.com.
Okay.
So if you go there, you can run a search and you can find all sorts of things about the Necronomicon and Simon and Lovecraft and how all these things kind of fit together. One of the things I did early in my blog was I developed it in response to the book Dead Names. So it's kind of going through Simon's claims one at a time.
Now, that's his latest book.
It's not quite his latest book. Okay. It was the one that was new at the time. It was the one where he basically tries to make a case for the reality of the Necronomicon, which, when you get down to it, amounts to, we had this manuscript. I can't really get anybody to talk about it other than me. I don't really have the manuscript anymore. All my photocopies faded. We don't really want to show you any notes from it, but it happened. This was really happened. That's kind of his story at this point.
And then he tries to connect it to like every ancient culture he can find.
Yeah. And he didn't do a very good job at it. I kind of read Dead Names, like, I could probably do a better job of this than, you know, in terms of just trying to come up with all sorts of evidence for it. But, it was a book. I guess he sold it. He got to make money off of it. He got to say, you know.
And the people who already believe it are going to eat it up.
Yeah, yeah.
So.
Yeah. It was interesting kind of how people have responded over the years. When the Necronomicon files came out, it was suddenly, we have something that we can use, you know, to tell people that the Necronomicon isn't real. That was kind of the internet response. And Dead Names came out and it was like all the Necronomicon aficionados came back and said, oh yeah, well this really shows Dan Harms that, you know, that what he was doing was incorrect. And I was thinking, well, not quite, you know, there's a lot of problems here. And so I've basically gone through and I've just, you know, kind of gone through each one of Simon's major points and said, well, you know, not really. There's not a lot of evidence that, you know, this book has ancient roots at all. And some of the stuff Simon presents is very selective. He takes little bits out of here and there.
Right, right.
With regard to people like the Yazidi and things like that, and just try to bolster his case. And it's really... I was like, well, you could use another group of Middle East. The Yazidi are actually a group which is interesting presently because President Obama has just authorized military strikes against people who are moving against the Yazidi, which is interesting because the Yazidi were at one time thought to be devil worshippers.
Right.
But they're, you know, they've got a very long and vibrant culture and they're very interesting. I looked at Simon's bit and I said, well, you should actually use the Mandaeans, which are, you know, another Middle Eastern group which has a lot of, you know, planetary imagery in them, because that works so much better. I mean, so it really, you know, there are some links in there. There's some, there's bits of actual lore in there. People have picked those out, and they are sometimes people to get put together genuine spiritual practices, and, you know, good for them. I think there's, I know I do talk with them. They seem to be fulfilled with what they do, but overall, it's not really an ancient work,
right?
By any means, yeah.
But it was a fantastic mind that the ideas came out of.
Mm-hmm. It definitely. I think that Lovecraft was probably the most influential writer of horror and science fiction in the 20th century, which is really saying something.
Yes.
When you think of everybody who's out there.
And I mean, when you look at even the dark side of it, like the racism side of it. People have accused Lucas of the same thing for very similar reasons,
mm-hmm.
you know, in the Star Wars trilogy saying, well, you know, these characters really represent this race and these characters represent this race. And there can be a case made there, too.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, Lovecraft, I think one of the things about Lovecraft's racism is that he was actually able to tap into, as it gets back to racism has very... or any sort of dislike of another group has very deep roots in our psyches. And he was able to tap into that. Now, of course, a lot of bad things have come out of tapping into that.
Oh, sure.
But that's, you know, it was once again being able to tap into something that's deep and resonates with people in terms of being afraid of something that's different
right,
of the
right,
other.
Right.
Yeah.
And that, I guess, gets blown up sometimes to these monsters.
Mm-hmm. That was a lot of it is, you know, well, you've got... places, stories like the Shadow Over Usenet, where you've got, you know, these inhuman creatures coming up and mating with people to, you know, so they can reproduce, and that's, you know, that's the root of the horror. There is the fear of, you know, the other coming in and kind of taking over and all that sort of thing.
And he has been thrown out now to every conceivable thing. You got other books written on his stuff. Mm-hmm. You have tons of movies, both made on his stories, but a lot of them like The Beyond.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the first few minutes are Lovecraft, and then the rest of the movie is their own invention based off of that.
Yeah, he has not been, for the most part, adapted well.
Yeah, and even you got like I thought Dagon was done very well, but it's actually mm-hmm. The Shadow Over Innsmouth.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is the one that everyone keeps redoing. There's one called Cthulhu, which was mm-hmm. done with a mostly gay cast. Tori Spelling was
yeah,
in it.
Yeah, that was actually one of the more interesting ones, more compelling ones.
But it was still The Shadow Over Innsmouth again.
Yeah, and it really was not a faithful adaptation of Lovecraft by any means. But it was, it was a good movie in its own right.
And then you have things like The Mouth of Madness, Into the Mouth of Madness, which was not Lovecraft, but it had that element to it.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like you just see it start to, these sort of tendrils going out through our culture. I mean, and right into comedy and stuff like that. You see Cthulhu showing up in South Park.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
There was a great online comic called Hello Cthulhu.
Yeah, yeah.
Which just killed me with Cthulhu and the Hello Kitty universe.
Mm-hmm.
And as you said earlier, the plush Cthulhus and things like that. And he just, he went from being almost unnoticed in the time of his life to now being so influential, and people don't even realize they're being influenced by him at a certain point.
Well, I think my favorite account to relate regard to that is the beginning of the first Hellboy movie with Guillermo del Toro. And he was going to put a Necronomicon quote at the beginning of that movie, his own made-up Necronomicon quote.
Mm-hmm.
But then he decided that the Necronomicon had been used too much. So he used a De Vermis Mysteries, which is another love occult tome. I'm sorry, mythos tome. And that's that's how saturated it is. When someone says, I could use something from Lovecraft here, but that's played out. I don't want to do that.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
And he was going to do it, The Mountains of Madness, and decided not to.
I think he's going to get back to it. From what I've heard, I'm not sure how faithful an adaptation that's going to be once again, but it'll be interesting to see what his take is. I think it's still something that no studio has really thrown a lot of money at, and that would be nice to see.
And he definitely has the feel for it.
Oh, yes, yeah.
And there's also the H.P. Lovecraft Historical Society that have done two movies, the silent film for The Call of Cthulhu, which was somewhat faithful.
Mm-hmm.
And what was the other one? Do you know?
The Whisper in Darkness.
That's it. Yes. Yeah. Which is somewhat faithful.
Faithful for about the first two acts. The third one, they're going up in an airplane and barnstorming and things like that. That was a little unusual. But
it was also made to look like it was made at the time that he was writing these stories.
Oh, yes, yes.
And so that was kind of interesting.
Yeah, that was a fun one.
But we're going to continue with Lovecraft in the show that I host after this, The Last Exit for the Lost. If you're listening to a podcast of this, you can find that at thelastexit.org. That show will be up. If you want to continue, we're going to get into the musical aspects of influence Lovecraft has had, mostly metal, but some other stuff as well. We've got some comedy mm-hmm. music we're going to be playing and some other weird stuff we're going to get into, but a little more lighthearted, not so much of the serious factual stuff now.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're listening live, just stay tuned and you'll hear The Last Exit. We're going to end. One more time, give people where they can find your stuff.
You can find my books and other things at writings at danharms.wordpress.com.
Okay. All right. And that's all you have up online? You can get all your stuff on Amazon?
Yeah, you should be able to find all the books on Amazon. There's actually links from the website to Amazon and other sellers for getting books on Lovecraft and on other topics from me.
Okay. And what do you have planned next?
Plan next, I'm just finishing up a huge book of Elizabethan magic with all sorts of strange incantations to spirits and things like that, which is coming out from Llewellyn in the spring.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. Okay. And how did Lovecraft die?
Lovecraft, a combination of intestinal cancer and Bright's disease. Basically, the current theory is that Lovecraft had horrible dietary tastes.
Mm.
I mean, just like eating canned food without heating it up first and, really, a lot of cake, a lot of cheese, a lot of, just bad food, that not a lot of greens at all. And basically, the current thought is he just, you know, his body could not really
function
like that. He thought he was really being frugal, and but there's some question about whether he just really needed to, you know, eat a little bit healthier.
I guess so.
So that's that. But yeah, it was a tragedy. He died when he was 46 years old.
Yeah. And how many? Do you know how many stories he wrote overall?
He wrote dozens.
All right.
He did not. I will say. I wouldn't give an estimate right off the top of my head, but he did not write as many as a lot of writers who would, you know, who wrote over the same sort of period would have. As I said, he put a lot of his energy just into writing letters to people instead of, you know, really buckling down and working on the fiction, and that's a shame.
What would you say the most misunderstood thing about H.P. Lovecraft was?
Most misunderstood thing about H.P. Lovecraft? I think that people don't understand how, you know, what a great influence he was on people in during his life. I mean, he was writing Robert Bloch, the guy who, you know, created Psycho. Mm-hmm. He was writing Robert E. Howard, who was the creator of Conan. And he was just such a, you know, great influence on people and just trying to get them to, you know, encouraging them to write, helping them write, you know, trying to put people in touch with each other. So he became this sort of major touchstone for, you know, this community, which was really behind the scenes and of which he was sort of the central figure. I mean, people think of Lovecraft as this recluse who, you know, never went out anywhere and didn't talk to people, but which was to some degree true. But he was also, you know, a very gregarious, very friendly sort of person who really, you know, I think cared about people.
All right. Well, I thank you. This has been fascinating.
Thank you.
And check one more time. WordPress?
Dan Harms, one word, at WordPress, dot WordPress.com.
All right. And we are going to hear, actually...